symbols and notations. Let f be a real valued function defined on the closed interval a comma b. Throughout our discussion, capital M and small m respectively denote the supremum and the infimum of a bounded function f defined on the closed interval a comma b, and capital MR and small MR be the supremum and the infimum of the function f respectively in the rth subinterval xr minus 1 comma xr of the interval a comma b. We know that capital M and small m are the supremum and the infimum of the given function respectively defined on the closed interval a comma b. Capital MR and small MR are the supremum and the infimum of the function f in the rth subinterval. We are going to learn how to find infimum and supremum of the given function and the infimum and supremum of each and every subinterval. For this, let us consider the x-axis and y-axis. Let y be the given function. Now, this is a given function. The given function is a curve. Normally, we consider a continuous curve. Here, we consider a discontinuous curve for the better understanding of the infimum and supremum. We have to find the area of the region under this curve and above the x-axis. To find the area of the region under the given curve and the x-axis, we normally fill this region with rectangles. For this, first let us divide the interval. Let us consider this is a given interval. Now we are going to divide the given interval into 5 sub-interval of equal length. First sub-interval, second sub-interval, third sub-interval, fourth one, fifth one. Normally, we divide the given interval into n equal sub-interval. Here, n is equal to 5. Let us consider the first sub-interval. Now, our aim is to find area of each sub-interval, then finally we have to add all these areas to get the area of the given region under the given curve and above the x-axis bounded by the two lines. Let us consider first one. We are going to evaluate the area of this region under this part of the given curve. For that, we have to fill this with a rectangle. Now, our aim is to find the infimum of each and every subinterval. Therefore, if you consider the first subinterval, this is the curve. We have to find the infimum of this curve. What is infimum? Infimum is the least value. So, in this curve, this point is the least value. Therefore, let us label this point as A. you want to find the area of this region which is going to filled with rectangle, we need the length and the breadth of the rectangle. This is the width because this is the least value. Look at this rectangle. This is a rectangle. We are going to find the area of this rectangle. For this, this is the width. What's the height? Height is this, from here to up to A. Therefore, let us take M1 is equal to F of A. Now, let us consider the second subinterval. We have to find the area of this region under this curve. If you consider the curve, this is a one part of the curve, this is another part. What is infimum here? Infimum is the least value. So which one gives the least value? This point gives the least value. Let us call it as B. Now we have to fill this area with rectangle. We can fill up to this. So we are left with this area and this area which are not included in this rectangle. So M2 is F of B. Coming to the third subinterval, we have to evaluate area of this region. For this, we have to fill this region with a rectangle. What is the least value? What is the infimum? The least value here is this point. So, let us consider the point and let us label it C. We have to fill this area with rectangle. Yeah, we have filled. Here also, we have not considered this area, but this area is included in the required area. Now, what is the height of this rectangle? The height of this rectangle is from x-axis to this point C. So, M3 is the infimum. Let us consider the fourth subinterval. We have to find the area under this curve and above the x-axis. So we have to fill this with a rectangle. But what is the least value here? In this arc, what is the least value? This is the least value. Let us call it as D. We are going to fill the fourth subinterval with rectangle. What is the infimum of this rectangle? Nothing but F of D. Let us call it as M4. So M4 is the infimum of this rectangle. Now coming to the fifth rectangle. Now coming to the fifth subinterval and the last subinterval. Actually, we have to find the area under this curve. For this, we are going to fill with rectangle. Since we are going to find the lower sum, we have to find the infimum of this subinterval. Consider the arc, the part of the given curve. What is the least value? This point is the least value. Let us call it as E. Now we are going to fill this area with rectangle. Yes, we can fill up to this only. So here the large rectangular part is left over. But this area must be calculated in the actual area of the region. F of E equals to M5. So thus we have found the infimum of subintervals. Let us coming to the other part, namely upper Riemann sum. For this, we need supremum of each and every subinterval. Consider the same curve y equal to f of x. This is the one, y equal to f of x. Here I have changed the color, that's all. But same curve only, I have changed the color. Now we are going to find the area under this curve. For this, we have to divide the given interval into n subintervals. For the clarity's sake, for the example point of view, again we are going to divide the interval into 5 equal subintervals. These are the 5 equal subintervals. Now we are going to find supremum of each subinterval. Coming to the first subinterval, we have to find the area of this region under the part of this given function. For this, we are going to fill this part with a rectangle. Since we are going to find the upper sum, we need to find the supremum of this interval. If we consider the curve, what is supremum? The highest point. Where is the highest value here? This is the highest value. Let us call it as x1. Now we are going to fill this area with a rectangle. Yes, we have filled. And remember that we are going to find the upper sum. Therefore, we have to fill this area. If you notice here, we have added the extra area here. So this area is extra, which is not included in the area which is to be calculated. What is the height of this rectangle? The height of rectangle is from x-axis to x1. Now what is supremum? Let us call it as capital M1 be the supremum of the first subinterval. Therefore, the supremum, namely M1, is equals to f of x1. Coming to the second subinterval, we have to evaluate area under this curve. For that, we have to fill this curve with a rectangle. We are going to find the upper sum. For this, we need to find supremum in this area. We need to find the supremum of the given curve in this subinterval. What is supremum? The highest value, the highest point. What is the highest point here in these two curves? Because it is disconnected, this point is the highest point. Call this point as x2. Now we are going to fill this subinterval with a rectangle. Yes, this is a rectangle. And remember that this part of the area and this part of the area are not included in the area which is to be calculated. Let us come to the third subinterval. Here we have to find the area under this curve. For this, we have to fill this area with a rectangle. Since we are going to find the upper sum, we need to find the supremum of this length. What is supremum of this part? The supremum is this point. Let us call it as x3. We are going to fill this third subinterval with a rectangle. Yes, here also we have added some extra area. What is M3? M3 is f of x3. Coming to the fourth subinterval, here what is the highest value? The highest value is somewhere here. So we call it as x4. We are going to fill this area with rectangle. Yes, we have filled. What is M4 now? M4 is f of x4. Coming to the last subinterval. here, what is the supremum? What is the highest value in this region? This point is the highest value. We call it as x5. Now we have to find the area under this curve. For this, we have to fill this region with rectangle. Let us fill it. See here. Here also, this is extra area which is not included in the required area which is to be calculated. What is M5? M5 is F of x5. Now if we consider the lower sum and upper sum, in the lower sum always we exclude area which are to be calculated. For example, in first subinterval this is not included, the second subinterval this is not included, in the third subinterval this part is not included, in the fourth subinterval this part is not included, in the fifth subinterval this part is not included. Whereas in the upper sum we have included extra area. For example, this part is included. Here this part is included. Here the third subinterval this part is included. In the fourth one the small area, in the fifth one the larger area, they are included. They are not in the actual area to be calculated. What is the width? The width is delta x. Here also delta x. So for both the lower sum and upper sum, delta x is the same for each and every sub interval. This is how we have to find infimum and supremum of every sub interval to calculate lower sum and upper sum. Now we are going to find the infimum and supremum of the function in both cases. We consider the lower sum. What is the infimum of the function? The whole curve. This is a curve. Here, what is the least value? It is clear that E is the least value. Therefore, we denote this point by P. Now, what is small m? Small m is the infimum of the function. So this P equals to F. Therefore the small m, infimum of the function, is equal to F of P. Therefore small m, which is the infimum of the given function, which is nothing but F of P, that is the value of the function F at this point. What about the supremum? Consider the curve. Where is the highest value? This point gives the highest value of the given function. Let us denote this point as Q. Now what is supremum? Capital M is the supremum of the given function. Therefore capital M is equals to F of Q. Thus, this point gives the infimum of the function. This point gives the supremum of the given function. Let us come to the upper sum. Here also we are going to find infimum and supremum of the given curve. Consider the given curve. What is the least value? This is the least value. Let us call it as P. What is small m? Small m is the infimum of the function. The infimum of the function is nothing but F of P. That is, small m is equal to F of P. What is the supremum of this function? Clearly, this point is the highest point. And consider this point as Q. And this point gives the supremum. Capital M is equals to F of Q, that is the supremum. Thus, if we consider either the lower sum or the upper sum for the given curve, M is same and capital M is also same. That is, either for lower sum or upper sum, the infimum and supremum of the given function are one and the same. That is, M is equal to f of p. See p here also same place, same value. Capital M equal to f of q. Here also capital M equal to f of q. And q is same value. The infimum or supremum of any interval need not be its endpoints. If you consider this, A is the endpoint of one of the endpoints or the first endpoint of the first interval. Here C is the beginning point. Here D is the endpoint. Here P is the endpoint. Whereas we come to the second subinterval, this P is not the endpoint. Whereas A, C, D and P are endpoints of the subinterval, either the first endpoint or the second endpoint. When you come to this case, consider here this point Q. This is not the endpoint of the subinterval. Whereas this is the endpoint, this is the endpoint, this is the endpoint, this is also endpoint. X4 is not the endpoint. For that sake only, we have considered disconnected curve. If you consider a connected graph, the function which is continuous, the function which is continuous, in that case, the infimum will be generally the first endpoint, supremum will be generally the second endpoint for the increasing function. That is, the function is an increasing function, or the curve is a continuous curve which is increasing, then the infimum will be the first n value of every subinterval and the supremum will be the second n point of every subinterval. Partition is an important point in Riemann integration. For every problem and theorem, we have to define a partition of the given interval. What do you mean by a partition? Partition is nothing but division. Partition P of the interval A comma B. By a partition, or the other names are dissections or a net of the interval A comma B, we mean a finite set of real numbers x0, x1, x2, xr, so on, xn, where the first point x0 is nothing but A and the last point nothing but B in the closed interval A comma B, such that, this is important, such that x0 is less than x1, less than x2, so on, less than xr, so on, less than xn. Partition of the closed interval A comma B is a finite ordered set. We already mentioned the finite, but this condition, the less than symbol condition, gives the order. Therefore, partition of the closed interval A comma B is a finite ordered set P equals to x0 comma x1 comma x2 comma so on xr so on xn, that is equals to B. The partition P of the closed interval A comma B consisting of n plus 1 points. Remember that we divide this closed interval into n equal subintervals, whereas the points are x0, x1, xr, so on, xn. It is starting with 0 and end with n. Therefore, this partition consisting of n plus 1 points namely x0, x1, x2, so on, xr, so on, xn, are called partition points.